Amen. If the Lord is still speaking to you, feel free to ignore me. He's more important to listen to than me. There's been some stuff said on the stream, and I think maybe I'll share that towards the end of some stuff that I've got to share, and then somehow we're going to pray about it. Normally we get into groups and do that. We can't really do that very well, but we'll have a think of how to do that. I'm sure God's got a good idea. I just need to tune in to him. I've been spending a bit of time this week in 1 Peter, not for any particular holy reason. That's just where I happened to be this week, and it's got lots of really cool stuff in it. And I just want to share some thoughts, really. This isn't a deep theological treatise of 1 Peter. You'll be pleased. Well, you might not be pleased. Apologies if that's what you're expecting. But I've just got a few thoughts I'd like to share with you. So we're going to be in 1 Peter chapter 4. And just a bit of an intro into 1 Peter while you're trying to find it in your Bibles or your phones. If you've got a phone, or if you're at home Googling it, it's probably a lot easier to do that rather than find it in the Bible. Some of you might be cheating and looking in the contents page. That's absolutely fine. There's no judgment here. If you get to Revelation, you've gone too... Well, obviously, you've gone too far if you get to Revelation. But it's one of those tiny little books, isn't it? You know, you get through the chunky kind of Hebrews and James in the New Testament. And then if you get too enthusiastic with your thumbing, you end up in Revelation. You might miss 1 Peter tucked away there. I think I might have said before one morning about 1 Peter that Martin Luther loved it. He said that... that it's one of the most significant and convincing works of the New Testament. He liked it. And I've heard it equated to being like one of those really small stones that you get stuck in your shoe. You know when you got the week in? I'm sure lots of you do that weekly. I've done it twice since I've been here, 2.5 years. The view doesn't change, does it? So, but you walk up the week in and you get a stone stuck in your shoe and you think, oh, I'll be fine, don't you? And then halfway through, you think, I need to get rid of that. And it's always the smallest little stone that you can hardly see that has the biggest impact. And some people have suggested that the book of 1 Peter is like that, this tiny little book, but it can interrupt your walk. So let's pray tonight before we get into it, shall we, that Jesus interrupts our walk with him tonight and brings us closer to him. So, Holy Spirit, would you, you're already here, would you make yourself even more present, more tangible as we open the word, please? And we want to hear what you've got to say to us tonight. We're really open, Lord, to being challenged by you tonight. So come, by your Spirit, we pray. Interrupt our walk. Amen. So, 1 Peter. There is the suggestion that for 1 Peter itself, clever people than me have dated it to around 60 AD, but there's a suggestion that when it was written kind of to a scattered people. You get that back at the beginning of 1 Peter. So it's written maybe to a scattered people, but some people reckon those people that were scattered were actually once at Pentecost a bit closer together. And I thought to myself, I like that because it makes me think a bit like what we're like. And I don't mean just here scattered kind of all over the place and at home. What I mean is that once we were lots of us together, if not in this building, we were at least together with our kind of church family where we often worship. But now we're scattered. And it's also true that 1 Peter was written into a context where people who follow Jesus were maybe not persecuted as such, but we're undergoing a bit of aggro, let's put it like that. And, you know, for us that are following Jesus in this day and age, we probably won't get fed to the lions, but it isn't cool to stand up and say you believe in Jesus. A great way to empty your room is to tell people what I do for a living. I'm sure it doesn't happen for Tim, but when I mention I'm a vicar, either people get overly interested or make any excuse to leave, which can be quite handy sometimes if you need a seat on a train, actually. There's a tip, wear a dog collar on a train, you'll get a seat. But it's not cool to be a Christian anymore, really, is it? And also, if you stand up and say, look, I believe Jesus is truth, people don't like that very much. It's not politically correct, is it? People feel very uncomfortable by that. And so 1 Peter being written into a situation where people are scattered, where people are kind of undergoing a bit of aggro for their faith, maybe a couple of thousand years later, that might be relevant to our walk today. So we're going to look at verses 7 onwards. So Peter's kind of talked a bit about Jesus, our living hope. He's talked about Jesus, the living stone. He's talked a bit about holy living. He's talked a bit about kind of submission. And then he talks about Jesus' submission and obedience to the Father and how that led him to the cross. And this is what we get to. 1 Peter 4, chapter 7. The end of all things is near. Cheers, Peter. Cheerful. The end of all things is near. Therefore, be alert and of sober mind so that you may pray. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. Wow. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength that God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. Amen. So, a few things I want to share from that. And it sounds a bit dramatic, doesn't it? When Peter kicks off, the end of all things is near. I get where Peter's coming from sometimes when I check out the news and see what's going on all over the planet. I can kind of get it. But I don't know about you, when I'm walking through town and I see someone with some of those sandwich boards on, you know the kind, the kind of evangelists that stand there with their sandwich boards, repent for the end is nigh. I'll be honest, I avoid them. I don't really want to talk to them, thank you very much. I'm in a rush, I'm too busy. And maybe that's understandable, but I wonder maybe, have we gone so far as if to say, oh, we can't say the end is near, that's ridiculous. So we've gone, instead of a nice little middle ground, we've gone all the way over there where we say, yeah, we can't, that's really weird to talk about that, isn't it? It's really strange to say the end is near. But remember, Peter had seen Jesus ascend from the Mount of Olives. You know, the angels who were there and they kind of, Peter and the disciples were watching Jesus go up. Oh, where's he gone? And the angels were like, what are you doing? Come on, get your gaze down. You're looking the wrong way. But they said, he's going to come back, the angel said, in the same way that he went up. And then we have the whole of the New Testament emphasizing the return of Jesus. We have the Apostle Paul that was like, it's going to happen soon. Get ready. And I wonder if we've gone so far the other way that if we see someone with one of those sandwich boards, we'll make any excuse to cross the road. It's really easy, isn't it, to ridicule those people that kind of are those doom mongers, we might call them. Now, of course, no one knows when Jesus will return. That is so true. But what we can say for certain is that he will return. And the reason I share this is because this week this has been making me think about how do I live my life in that kind of viewpoint that Jesus is coming back. Might be 10 o'clock tonight. I hope not. I'm preaching tomorrow and I've prepared it. That'd be a waste. But it might be. It might be 150 years' time. We have no idea. But we do know he is the coming king. And we look, don't we, for the reign of Jesus that's going to bring judgment and it's going to bring justice and a new creation. So the challenge is, with verse 7, can we join in with Peter and say, yeah, the end of all things is near. It might not be today, it might not be tomorrow, but it's definitely nearer than it was when I began my talk. The end is inevitable. The return of Jesus is inevitable. And this inevitable return leads Peter on to some challenges. And there are three, well, he gives a few, but there are three challenges I want us to think about briefly tonight. And the first thing he says is, be alert and of sober mind so that you might pray. So there's a sense that when we grow in our understanding of the return of Jesus, this leads us to be alert, sober-minded. Or self-controlled is another way of looking at that. It's the same word used in Mark 5 and Luke 8 at the deliverance of the demoniac. I can never say that. The demoniac. Is that right? There you go, the demoniac. Yes, I'm getting a thumbs up from the vicar. I must be right. The demoniac. It's a bit of a posh word, isn't it? But it's the same word used when the crowd go back to this man who's been delivered of demons and he's sat there in his right mind. You know, it's a major event. This is a big thing. This self-control is only possible through the supernatural power of the Holy Spirit. So we wait for Jesus' return, not in like a frenzy, but in a way that's ready for service. And I think we do that by keeping ourselves grounded in Jesus. It's quite simple, really, isn't it? Well, it's simple to say that we keep our perspective with that sense that, yeah, the return is near, but we don't know when it's going to be. A way that helps me think about it is like an athlete on the, what they call, the bit where they're about to run. I'm not an athlete. I don't know if you can tell that or not with the amount of time I spend in gratitude eating breakfast, but I'm not an athlete. But you know when they go ready, steady, and they're poised, and they're waiting? They're not going anywhere. They might as well be sat around, mightn't they? No, because they're poised and they're ready to go. I wonder if that helps us when we think of how we need to be for the return of Jesus. So there's the first challenge for us. In the light of Jesus' return, are we sober-minded? Are we self-controlled? But we're also challenged to love each other deeply. That's the second one. And love like that can only happen, can't it? Because he first loved us. Love never fails. And I was challenged this week, how's my love? How's my love for God doing? How's my love for my fellow Christians doing? How's my love for people that I don't know? How's my love for people that really irritate me? Of course, no one irritates us because we're Christians, right? And we're lovely. But if someone happened to annoy us once in our lifetimes, could we love them passionately, constantly? That's another way this word could be translated, constant love. And the other thing to remind ourselves tonight is, do you know God loves you? Of course we do, right? We're Christians, yeah. But I've been thinking this week, wow, God loves me. I say it, we say it all the time, don't we? God loves me. And once we get that, we start maybe really looking forward to the return of Jesus. And what does this love do? In the next few verses, love causes us to want to serve each other. And this is the thing maybe I felt as I was going through this, that for some of us, maybe we're feeling in this season, God calling us to serve, maybe in a new way. Maybe in a scary way. But that can only happen out of a love for others and for God. That's what this suggests here. And it says, doesn't it, administering God's grace in verse 10, administering God's grace in various forms. Various. There's so many different ways that we can serve. It's like a multicolored tapestry of grace is one thing I read about it when I was doing some reading about it this week. A multicolored tapestry. This sense that however we serve, it's all in different ways, but it comes together as the body of Christ. My friends, each and every one of us is called to be a minister. We're each called to serve the church. We've each got different gifts that the Holy Spirit gives us. And in the light of the coming King, I wonder if God's calling some of us tonight to use our gifts a bit more fervently, maybe to step out into a new place that might be a bit scary. And in fact, a few chapters ago, Peter writes this. He says, "You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession." That's you. Tonight, you are special, you're royal. We sung that earlier. You're a holy nation, you're God's special possession. Now you are the people of God. When I left teaching and went into Vicar Factory, or Theological College, if you'd like to be posh, I had to cut down quite a few people that were saying, "Oh, you're going into ministry now, are you?" But no, I'm lucky enough to be being paid for it. Let's not get that wrong. But I was always in ministry. This sense, isn't there, that the people at the front on the stage or whatever are the ministers. And other Christians that maybe do stuff every now and again. But actually this sense that we are all called to be ministers. God has given us gifts. And in the light of his coming, he is urging us, come on guys, we can do this. So I wonder tonight if you feel God's Spirit asking you to serve, maybe to step into a new area of ministry. And maybe this is an encouragement from you that, yeah, you know what, the end is near. Jesus is coming. Go for it. And finally, as we as we come into land, if we do serve, we do it, in verse 11, in his strength, the strength that God provides. Because then all the praise and glory goes to him. You know, Peter saw loads of stuff, didn't he? Peter, you know, did some dramatic healings and miracles. He'd seen the lame walk. He'd been gifted with a ministry that was prophetic and of bold preaching. But here he reminds people, it's not about the minister. It's about giving glory to God. And that Jesus is only fully glorified when each one of us steps into what he's given us to do in the power of his Holy Spirit. So I wonder which of those three things maybe most rests in your heart tonight. Is it that God is calling you to be on the starting block, kind of self-controlled, sober-minded, but ready and watchful? Do you know maybe in your heart that it's love that you need to work at? You know, there's no condemnation, remember, for those that are in Jesus. But sometimes the Lord just lovingly convicts us a bit. Maybe it's just me, but I hear him coming up to me and go, David, you were a bit of a numpty when you did that, weren't you? Come on, you can do better. I love you, but pull your socks up. So maybe tonight, if you're feeling that's the love that you need to sort out, that's okay. We come before God and he forgives us and we say, Lord, I need your help at being more loving. Or I need your help in accepting that you love me. Or maybe for some of us, there's a real sense that God is calling us into a new ministry or a different kind of way of serving. And that this sense that the Lord is coming is something that maybe is giving you a bit of an extra nudge. So I think what we'll do is have some music playing in the background and maybe just 5 or 10 minutes or so to be still. If you're near someone, I think you're allowed to pray. No, you're not allowed to pray. If you're with someone in a bubble, please pray with them. If you would like, let's think how we can do this. If you're okay for someone to kind of pray and it's a public thing, feel free to put on the stream that you'd like someone to pray for you. We can't come to you, but we will still pray for you. If it's something that's a bit more private, maybe drop us an email later. That's a good way of doing it. It's not ideal, but that's the way we'll do it. And then towards the end of this 5 or 10 minutes, I've got some things that I'll read out, and then we'll end with a bit more music. Okay, great. So Holy Spirit, would you continue to speak to us now, please, as we just have a moment to see what it is you're challenging us about tonight. Lord, you are the coming King. You are returning in glory and justice and judgment and new creation. And Lord, our walk with you needs to be impacted by that. So Holy Spirit, come.